I do want to welcome a great guest here in studio with us, Nick McKinley, the CEO of the Deliver Fund. Nick, good to see you again.
Hey, thanks for having me. It's good to be back.
Yeah, you're a Billings, Montana native. We last caught up with you in the Flathead.
That's right.
And then you eventually ended up serving in the CIA.
I did. I did about a decade in Air Force Pararescue, kind of one of the lesser known of the special operations community. Went to the CIA. And then eventually, you know, found myself back here in Montana. You know, I had to come back to my roots.
Yeah, and the Air Force Pararescue, I've just heard incredible things about them, and based on the ones that I've gotten to meet, just incredible guys. Basically, if you ever get lost in a very bad place and you need somebody to come get you, they're the guys that you want to come get you. They're the guys that will be likely the ones to come get you.
We like to think so. You know, it's kind of the worse the conditions, the more fun it is for us.
Nick McKinley, it's so great to have you here on the show. The Deliver Fund, you're basically bringing together former special operations and law enforcement folks, intelligence operatives, and putting those tools to work to go after these human traffickers is how I kind of summarize it for my friends. But we know that human trafficking is a big problem here in Montana, that there's a big hub for it here in Montana. This is not just a third world country problem. This is a Montana problem. How important is local law enforcement? You know, this defund the police push, it's unfortunately, you've probably seen the headlines in places like Bozeman and Helena. There's an effort to defund the police. How important are local law enforcement to your human trafficking problem set?
They're the only people who can actually go after the human traffickers. I mean, let's look at this. And, you know, one of the things that is just driving me crazy is the division and the sheer lack of literacy around some of these issues. Like people are reading, you know, news tickers instead of actually, you know, actually looking at data. And the reality is that, you know, everywhere that we've defunded the police so far in this country, we've seen a spike in crime. So if you want to defund the police, the results of that are linearly predictable. Like, we know exactly what's going to happen. We can actually do the math on it. So, you know, in Montana specifically, there's a big conversation around the missing and Indigenous women issue. And that's it's an incredibly important issue. And everybody says, okay, well, we need to go do more about that. Absolutely, we need to do more about that.
And there's marches and there's walks and there's paintings.
Cool.
And that's great. But yes.
No march ever helped any missing woman ever. What helps a missing woman is a cold, calculating detective who's well-trained and well-paid and well-funded, who's out there trying to figure out what happened. You know, when a child goes missing, the person who does something about that is the law enforcement agency. I was with John Walsh at the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children in Washington, D.C., and he took me up to the third floor, and I could go up there since I had a security clearance. And the third floor is all law enforcement, right? So you have the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children, which is not a government agency. It is a private nonprofit. It gets $60 million a year in government funding, but it is a private nonprofit. And who's on the third floor? Law enforcement. Because those law enforcement officers are taking the investigations that nonprofit does and then distributing them to other law enforcement officers so that they can go take action. And you, in order to take action, and this is a really important point, you have to be an agent of the state. If you go take action against another person, well, there's a word for that. It's rogue vigilante. And in most cases, you're committing a felony if you do that. So if you defund the police, well, we may as well defund prosecutors, because there's not going to be anybody to bring criminals to them, in which case we're not going to need judges, because even if a judge does issue a warrant, who's going to serve that warrant? Who's actually going to take the action? And so we don't need to be defunding the police. We need to refund the police. We need to give them more training. We need to give them bigger levels of respect. We need to hold the bar of police recruitment and training higher, and we need to give our law enforcement officers the resources to do that. And people shouldn't be upset with the police. They need to be upset with our politicians, because at the end of the day, your police chief does and executes on the orders that the mayor gives him.
Yeah, and that's what we saw in Seattle. The police chief there was saying, look, I want to go in. I want to disrupt this autonomous zone. I want to stand up for my officers. But at the end of the day, the mayor calls the shots. Exactly. But this is also a good reminder. Like, okay, don't claim, this is my opinion at least here, don't claim to care about human trafficking. Don't claim to care about missing and murdered indigenous women. And then on the other hand, work to defund the police or say, well, we're just going to fund mental health care workers instead. We're going to take funding here. Fund mental health care workers, yes, but don't take it away from law enforcement, because just like you said, you guys with the Deliver Fund do incredible work to in this human trafficking fight. But at the end of the day, law enforcement has to be the one to ultimately go in and disrupt and arrest and prosecute these cases. Nonetheless, though, give us just, we got about a minute and a half before our next break. Give us some of the numbers, just perspective on what Deliver Fund does to fight human trafficking.
So what we do is we equip, train, and advise law enforcement. We exist because there is not enough funding for police, for human trafficking specific units. So you might have one, maybe two law enforcement detectives in a major metropolitan area. I just came from Albuquerque, New Mexico. There was one human trafficking detective on the local PD, one metro area of over 1 million people. So what is that one person going to do? Well, they can't do a whole lot by themselves. And so we wrap around them and we provide them with the intelligence, we provide them with the tools, and we provide them with the training they need to be able to execute on their job. And in some cases, we actually embed law enforcement, or we embed analysts within law enforcement human trafficking task forces to inform their cases.
The Deliver Fund, an incredible organization that's helping to fight human trafficking, and doing an incredible job at it, by the way. Two Montana guys started this organization, Jeremy Mayhew, the Navy SEAL from Whitefish, and Nick McKinley, a CIA and Air Force veteran from Billings. He's back in studio with us today. Nick McKinley, the CEO of the Deliver Fund. We've been talking about how crazy this concept of defunding the police is. And look, if you care about missing and murdered indigenous women and you want to help find these women, if we defund the police, it would be devastating in that fight. But human trafficking, if you are concerned about the human trafficking fight, at the end of the day, those arrests are going to be made. Those investigations are going to be conducted. Those traffickers are going to be prosecuted by law enforcement. If you defund them, you are making the situation worse. So we've talked about that. The other question I also wanted to get to here with Nick McKinley is just talking, hey, what's it like, you know, for law enforcement and fighting human trafficking and some of these other things in the era of COVID-19, because we know these problems haven't gone away. In some cases, maybe they're even more hidden right now. So how is that impacting things? We'll start there right after our Farm and Ranch report from our friend Lane Nordland.
This is Where Montana Talks Ag with Lane Nordland.
For many months now, the livestock industry has been anticipating the release of USDA's investigation into boxed beef and fed cattle price spread fluctuations. Well, on Wednesday, part of that investigation was released with an update. Agriculture Secretary Perdue says the closure of the Tyson beef packing plant following a fire at a facility in Holcomb, Kansas, and the COVID-19 pandemic did clearly disrupt the markets and processing systems responsible for the production and sale of U.S. beef. But the investigation is far from complete. U.S. Senator John Tester weighed in.
Lane, it kind of tells us what we already know, and the Secretary is correct. What I saw in that report, what those findings are, and that's what they are, is basically a report of findings, is that live cattle and boxed beef move further apart with the fire with Holcomb and with COVID-19, and pretty significantly too, not a small amount.
At this point of the investigation, the report does not examine potential violations of the Packers and Stockyards Act by packers. However, should USDA find a violation of the act, it is authorized to report the violation to the Department of Justice. If you recall, the Department of Justice also has its own investigation looking into the matter. The full 20-page report can be found online. I'm Lane Nordland. Have a great day.
All right, Lane, thanks for that report. Back into it here with Nick McKinley, the CEO of the Deliver Fund. Yeah, back to this this concept of defund the police for just a moment, because you were talking about just how critical, how we not only need to not defund the police, we need to fund the police. They need more resources. You know, I know, you know, one organization, the Mason Moore Foundation, in honor of the fallen Deputy Mason Moore, they do an incredible job of raising funds for extra protective equipment for officers and things like that. But I know, I think it was either you or Jeremy Mayhew was telling me this, that you guys offer free training for law enforcement.
That's right.
For human to fight human trafficking. And I think you guys were telling me you had an officer from Eastern Montana, just to show you how underfunded a lot of these law enforcement agencies are. He drove down there and slept in his vehicle, was willing to sleep in his vehicle, basically, yeah. Because they couldn't afford to put him up in a hotel. But he wanted to go through that training so badly that he was willing to sleep in his car if he had to while he was down in Texas for the training.
Not only that, he drove down on his own dime, took vacation in order to get the training, because his department could not afford to give him the overtime or the vacation time in order to be able to do this. He couldn't do it paid. So he took his own vacation and did it like that. That is the heart of the average law enforcement officer in this country. Are there bad law enforcement officers? Absolutely. Nobody's denying that. So let's just take that off the table. And why are there bad law enforcement officers? Well, it's because the pay is too low. So they're just not getting in the level of talent that they want. So they've got to fill the slot with somebody. And every, you know, behind closed doors, every police chief, every sheriff will tell you that there's some people that they had to hire that they wish they didn't. So let's not put them in that position anymore. Let's make these incredibly competitive jobs that are attracting the best talent. Let's give them the best resources. Let's hold the feet of bad law enforcement officers to the fire. And let's make sure that the good law enforcement officers have what they need. Because at the end of the day, if you have a child, if you're listening to this and you're a parent or a grandparent or an aunt or an uncle, and a child that you care about goes missing, law enforcement is who's going to do something about it. And so it's the irony is not lost on me, and I'm sure it's not on you, for people who claim to care about missing kids but then want to defund the police.
Yeah.
People who claim to care about human trafficking but then want to defund the police. Like, you don't get to have it both ways.
And of course, everything's been weird in 2020. Everything's been crazy in 2020 with coronavirus, COVID-19. But I've been wondering, because in some instances, other health problems are getting worse as kind of negative side effects of economic shutdowns and COVID-19 restrictions and just people just going crazy in general. But I wonder, from a law enforcement standpoint, is human trafficking getting worse right now? Is, you know, are some of these other problems, are we taking our eye off the ball because so much focus is now on other things? Is the human trafficking problem getting worse right now? What are you seeing?
Yes, it is getting worse. And part of that is, you know, the mental health issues associated with the lockdown. A big part of that is the economic devastation that has happened, where now you have, primarily women who are choosing to become prostitutes, but then they very quickly become abducted because, you know, one of those customers turns out to be a human trafficker, and they become abducted and now they become a trafficking victim. We're also seeing that law enforcement has less room to maneuver right now because, you know, their resources are being tied up with riots and you know, mask enforcement and all this other stuff. So those officers are not available to fight human trafficking because that department is underfunded and undermanned to begin with.
Yeah, and we heard that out of Lake County, Montana, where they said, stop calling our 911 call center with these disputes, with mass disputes or anything else. Look, it's not enforceable, so we're not going to be sending people out. But separate from that, that's why, Matt, if you had a kid go missing right now, would you want the 911 call center to be flooded with a bunch of nonsensical phone calls?
Right.
You know, you would want every line to be available in case that important tip came in. The mask thing, I wonder, is it harder to catch these people because people can easily walk around with their face covered? And, you know, if somebody's walking around with a mask and face covering on 6 months, you'd be like, who the heck is this guy?
Right.
If there's a manhunt for a wanted suspect, is it harder to track these suspects down now because of so many people wearing masks?
Not with not with our methodologies. I mean, if you're looking at old school, you know, physical on the ground methodologies, sure, I'm sure it makes things more difficult, but not with what we do. I mean, what we do is almost 100% cyber based. People aren't wearing masks online. The commercial sex advertising industry, which is what we really target, they're not wearing masks on the advertisement. So all of the various facial recognition algorithms still work. So it really hasn't caused much of a disruption for us. In fact, the disruption has been on the law enforcement side, because on the Deliver Fund side, COVID has actually made it easier for us to find human traffickers.
Because it's disrupted, if we want to use it in a military terminology, you've disrupted the enemy's operations.
That's
so
right.
So they've had to change the way they do business, I guess.
That's exactly it. They've had to move. And to continue with your military analogy, when can you see the sniper on the hillside? When they're forced to move. When they're sitting still, you can't see them. But when they're forced to move and they're forced to run, well, that's what COVID created, was a market disruption that allowed us to exploit that market disruption for the purposes of finding them. So we can find them easier. However, there's less law enforcement available. And part of the reason, too, is because the environment has become so tenuous for law enforcement. Law enforcement officers are quitting in droves.
Yeah.
They're just saying, you know what? I'm not going to go work for pennies anymore for people who don't appreciate me. Instead, I'm just going to go join this tech company, or I'm going to go sell something and I'm going to make three times as much money with half the stress. And so law enforcement officers are quitting in droves.
Yeah, or why would I go in and have an altercation and then now I'm on CNN the next day getting called all sorts of names? I could even understand a hesitancy to respond to some of these calls. Speaking of callers, we got Katie on the line in Northwest Montana. Katie, did you have a quick question or comment? We got a couple minutes left here with Nick McKinley.
Yes, my question is how to inform the public. Because just recently I'm told there was a bust here at the Quetucnuck in Billings, Montana, 2 weeks. I'm a child and youth trauma specialist for this Confederated Salish Kootenai tribe. Education. My question is, why is the local law enforcement people not putting this in the papers when these busts are made, or making it a public awareness? How do we be politically correct in educating our...
That's a good question. Yeah. Yeah. So how do you get the word out of the public, especially sometimes if there's an ongoing investigation? They don't want to mess up the investigation if it gets into the news too much. And I've heard that. But your thoughts, Nick?
So I think Katie just highlighted the entire defund the police movement in one comment. And I don't think she realized that she did it. And thank you, Katie. It was an incredibly important question. We said, how do we get law enforcement to get this into the papers? Last I checked, it's not law enforcement's job to put this in the papers.
How do we get the word out about these cases? And you and I kind of talked, that was a good question that she raised and good point that she made about we need to get the word out when these human trafficking busts are made or other cases. And that onus is on all of us. But, you know, you and I were talking during the break. It's like, okay, well, even if law enforcement feels they can't send out a press release, or they don't have the time or the resources to do, or they don't want to jeopardize an investigation, well, okay, mayors, okay, county commissioners, okay, state senator so-and-so, you send out the press release. You tell the press about it to help get the word out when this type of stuff. You pat law enforcement on the back. I don't know. Anything else you want to tell our listeners here, Nick?
Yeah. Every listener to this program most likely is a voter, or is a very well-informed, soon-to-be voter. And the responsibility lies with you. Because the reason that your politicians are not caring as much about these issues as you is because you're not loud enough. Politicians work for the people. That's the way the republic is set up, or supposed to be anyway. Our police chiefs, the various folks then who are appointed by the politicians, they work for those politicians. And Jocko Willink, former Navy SEAL officer, who coined the term extreme ownership. And it's a really, really good way to talk about where the responsibility should lie in all of these different pieces. We can't expect the President of the United States to fight our local battles. That's not the way our country is set up. It's our local politicians. And, Jeremy, who, I was I haven't done a whole lot of really smart things in my life, but I picked a phenomenal wife and I picked phenomenal, you know, co-founders and business partners. And Jeremy's one of those. And he says, you know, all politics is local. Obviously, he got that from when he was working for Ryan Zinke when he was a congressman. And he said, you know, and he's absolutely right. All politics is local. So if you're concerned about the behavior of your police, don't talk to your police about it. Talk to your mayor. Hold your mayor accountable. If you don't like the way that the state is funding your state police, then you need to talk to your state senators and your state politicians about that. You need to talk to your governor about that.
I mean, and likewise, if you don't like the law, don't get mad at the person enforcing it.
Exactly.
And if you don't like directives or anything else, well, then take it out on the politicians who are putting these types of things in place in the first place, not on the people trying to enforce this stuff. Nick McKinley, how can folks get a hold of you? How best can the Deliver Fund help folks here in Montana?
So the best way to get a hold of us is through our website, deliverfund.org, or you can follow us on social media at Deliver Fund. You can find me on social media at Deliver Fund Nick. And the best way to help is to, you know, is to join our fight. We can't do the work that we do without the generosity of people. And